to man or him, and this Declaration of Independence does not refer to women. So independence actually was given to males and not to females. Then they used to say, as John Blum has written in his book, Government by the People, he says, early American men would not accept them and women as equals. This was the ancient history. Then 4th June 1999, American Congress and Senate passed the bill. It was the bill of 19th Amendment of American Constitution, Article 19, which stated the right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. So in 1919, the law of equality of male and female and discrimination was removed. Equality law was given, and then the vote to right was allocated to women in America. In France, 1848, 7th February was the government day when they approved the right of women to vote. And then there is a long list, no need to go in all details. After mentioning this modern, present, Western constitutional history, those people who have taken up the arms against democracy, and those Muslim leaders who consider democracy as kufr and they want to fight against democracy, now I want to invite their attention. You have listened. These are the constitutional developments of the Western world. Let me explain what is the constitutional position of Islam as regard to parliament and the right of women 1500 years before. In the days of Sayyidina Umar, ladies were members of Islamic parliament. In days of Sayyidina Umar, I am quoting this hadith from Tafsir Ibn Kasir. I am quoting from Ibn Abdul Barr Jami al-Ilm. I am quoting by Imam Qurtubi of his Tafsir. I am quoting Imam Suyuti from Ad-Durr al-Mansur. I am quoting from Al-Ajluni from Kashf al-Khifa and many other books on Islamic law, Islamic history, and Islamic culture, and Islamic hadith. In the days of Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Umar once, he presented a bill. Bill was regarding to seal the limit of dower for women. The people were fixing maximum dowers for women at the time of marriage, but they were not paying them as their right. Sayyidina Umar thought that there should be a limit in fixing of dower. Such limit is to be fixed so that male husbands would easily pay that fixed dower to their wife after their marriage ceremony. So he wanted to pass that bill, and bill was related to limit the right of dower. This bill was on the floor of the parliament, and a member of the parliament who was a lady, a woman, sitting in the parliament as the member, she stood up on the floor of parliament and she carried the bill presented by the caliph, by head of the state, Sayyidina Umar. She carried the validity of the bill and she said, "Oh Umar, if Allah has not limited our right of dawa, who are you to limit our right? You can't put any ceiling on our right of dawa." Then Sayyidina Umar stood up. He asked that lady, the member of parliament sitting in the House of Parliament, asked, "What is the argument and evidence on which basis you are saying that Allah, the God of Quran, has not fixed any limitation on dawa? What is your evidence?" She recited a verse of Holy Quran. She said, "Allah has said in Quran, وَآتَيْتُمْ إِهْدَاهُنَّ قِنْطَارَ. If you have given them heaps of gold and silver, even in dawa, even then you cannot take them back if any separation or divorce takes place. So So the world heaps of gold tells that there is no limit on the right of dower. When she quoted this verse as evidence, Sayyidina Umar, the caliph, head of the state, stood up again and he announced on the floor of parliament, he said, Imratun Asabat Varajulun Akhta. This lady gave the right opinion and I was wrong. So I withdraw my bill. And this Lord with you. This was the supremacy of legislature. This was independence of parliament. And this was the constitutional position of women 1500 years before today. They were given the right constitutional right of becoming the member of parliament. And Sayyidina Umar stated, Imratun khasamat Umar fa khasamatu. A lady, she argued with Umar, the head of the state, and finally she won the case, and I had lost my case. I withdrew from her. This whole statement has been given by Imam Abdul Razak in Al-Musannaf, and same has been narrated by Imam Shawkani in Nail al-Awtar. So at that time, not only the ladies were the members of parliament, big administrative and judicial positions were given to ladies in the days of Khulafa-e Rashideen. Abdullah, Shafa bint Abdullah Adawiya, she was appointed as the Chief Justice of Market Administration in the days of Caliphate. A lady, Shafa bint Abdullah Adawiya, she was head of the Accountability Court. A lady was appointed as the head of the Accountability Court. Sayyidina Umar, his administration. Again, Hazrat Kulsoom, daughter of Sayyidina Ali, she was appointed once as ambassador to the Empire of Rome. And she headed the delegate of diplomats to Rome. And she was received by the Queen of Rome. And they announced that the daughter of Ali, as the ambassador representing the Muslim state, has arrived. So we are together here to receive her. And this right was constitutionally given to ladies that if there was a war and if a single woman would like to provide a guarantee, a treaty of protection, she wanted to give any non-Muslim. So constitutionally she was allowed to provide the security to non-Muslim. If one lady give, and it is written in Islamic jurist books that even one lady was entitled constitutionally to provide the right of security to a very big group of non-Muslims, those who sought for security. These were the rights given to the ladies. And during the time of the election of Sayyidina Usman, it is stated in Tabari, Jame Tabari, this is the famous book of Tabari and Ibn Sa'd, that the final thing on this democracy. First of all, the case, there were two candidates, Sayyidina Umar, when he was leaving. One candidate was Sayyidina Ali, one was Sayyidina Usman. Democratically, nobody was nominated. The case was referred to upper house, but the opinion was divided. Then the case was referred to the parliament. Who should be chosen as head of the state, next head of the state? Parliament at that time consisted of 50 members. Again, the opinion was equally divided. 25 members were in favor of Usman, 25 members were in favor of Sayyidina Ali, radiyallahu ta'ala anhumah. Again, opinion was divided. Then the parliament of Medina appointed Abdul Rahman bin Auf, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, as chief election commissioner. He was appointed as chief election commissioner. And general elections took place for 3 days, general elections. And it is written in Tabari and Ibn Sa'd that the vote were casted at that time, giving opinion was known as vote. That was the way. That opinion was taken by every single member of the military, civil services, male, female, and every single adult person of the society voted for. And on the basis of the majority votes, Sayyidina Usman was declared to be the next head of the state. These were some of the examples which I gave just to